Well, hey, good morning, everybody. Welcome to CEFC and happy 4th of July weekend. Hopefully this weekend is a nice extended time for you, a little extra time off, maybe getting the kayak out, going to the lake or grilling some burgers or doing what you do. Hopefully it's a good time for you guys. Let me tell you a little bit about CEFC, especially if you are here for the very first time. We're going to sing a few songs in just a minute with this band that's behind me, and they're going to do a great job. It's got a great song selection this morning. And then we're going to hear a message from our lead pastor, Phil, who's fresh back from vacation, so looking forward to that. He's continuing in a message series we started a few weeks ago called Blind Spots, so it should be a good one. But our mission here at CEFC is to help people take their next step closer to Jesus. So if you're with us here in the room or joining us online, it's really our hope and it's our prayer for you all week long that you find out what your next step closer to Jesus looks like today. And we hope that happens for you guys as we're together for about 60 minutes. And we hope that's the best 60 minutes of your week. Well, hey, one thing I just wanted to share with you is kind of fun information. Our student ministry is actually on a trip this week. This is a picture of them behind me. They left yesterday morning and they headed out to Kansas City to do a trip called Challenge. So they're out there for an entire week just hearing messages and spending some time together and having a chance for them to grow in their relationship with Jesus. So if you guys consider yourselves praying people, and we hope you do, spend some time praying this week for that crew because they need some safe travels, and they're on their way now, and then they'll be coming back next weekend as well, and hopefully it's just a great, inspiring week for them. Hey, that's all the info I got. Why don't you guys stand up, say hello, and happy 4th of July to the people around you, and we're going to get going.
Your heart stirs your soul. Matters come to mind. The cares you keep, the thoughts you think, it's not all wasted time. Seeking you will find. Joy still comes in the morning. Hope still walks with the hurting. You're still alive and breathing. Praise the Lord. Don't stop dancing and dreaming. Still good news worth repeating. So lift your head and keep singing. Praise the Lord. Years roll by, we wonder why we lost our way from home. A father finds the child inside, we left for growing old. Awake, 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 my soul. Joy still comes in the morning, and hope still walks with the hurting, but you're still alive and breathing. Praise the Lord. Don't stop dancing and dreaming. There's still good news worth repeating. So lift your head and keep singing. Praise the Lord. Let everything, let everything, let everything praise the Lord. Let everything, let everything, let everything praise the Lord. Let everything, let everything, let everything praise the Lord. Let everything, let everything, let everything praise the Lord. Let everything, let everything. Let everything praise the Lord. Let everything, let everything, let everything praise the Lord. Joy still comes in the morning. Hope still walks with the hurting. You're still alive and breathing. Praise the Lord. Don't stop dancing and dreaming. Still good news worth repeating. So lift your head and keep singing. Praise the Lord. still comes in the morning, and hope still walks with the hurting. You're still alive and breathing. Praise the Lord. Don't stop dancing and dreaming. There's still good news worth repeating. So lift your head and keep singing. Praise the Lord. Your heart be troubled. Just hold your head up high. Don't fear no evil. Just fix your eyes on this one truth. God is madly in love with you. So take courage, hold on, be strong. Remember where our help comes from.
Whoa! you heavens, let the praise go up as the walls come down. All creation, everything with breath repeat the sound. All his children, clean hands, pure hearts, good grace, good God. His name is Jesus. Our salvation is in his blood. Jesus, he's a light of heaven. He's a friend forever. His kingdom come.
For those of you that don't know me, my name's Chris, and I have been blessed with the amazing opportunity to get married to my best friend in November. And I'm extremely excited about it. Not so sure she is, but that's to be determined. But for as many of you that know that planning a wedding can be super stressful at times. And, you know, there's some unwarranted disagreements and stuff that come about. And unfortunately, I'm going through that right now with a family member that I love so dearly. And it's made me want to lash out in ways that would be hurtful, not only to her, but the father as well. So it's just been, this has been a season of trying and persevering through the trials that God knows that we're gonna have faith-shaking troubles, but it's relying on him through these troubles and just grasping on him and just asking for help and guidance through any and every situation. He does so many things for me and for us that I just is indescribable. So as we sing this next song, just know that we are not alone within our sorrows and that he died for us and rose for us for our freedom.
Dead in my sin, lost without hope, with no place to begin. Your love made a way to let mercy come in. When death was arrested, my life began. My chains, I'm a prisoner no more. My shame was a ransom he faithfully bore. He canceled my debt and he called me his friend. Yeah. Oh, when death was arrested in my life. Over me, you have made me new. Now life begins with you. It's your endless love pouring down on us. You have made us new. Now life begins.
your dark. Our Savior displayed on a criminal's cross. Darkness rejoiced as though heaven had lost. But then Jesus arose with our freedom and hail. And that's when death was arrested and my life began. That's when death was arrested and my life began. Oh, your grace, so free, washes over me. You have made me new, now life begins with you. It's your end. Endless love pouring down on us. You have made us new, now life begins with you. Oh, we're free, free, forever we're free. Come join the song of all the redeemed. Yes, we're free. Death was arrested and my life began. Oh, we're free, forever we're free. Come join the song of all the redeemed. Yes, we're free, free, forever, amen. When death was arrested and my life began. When death was arrested and my life began. That's when death was. And my life begins.
That's awesome. You guys can go ahead and grab a seat. You know, as we were singing this song, I was reminded of a time when I was something like 20 years old, maybe in the best shape of my life, and I was on the beach just going for a swim. And it was interesting because while I was swimming, I got pulled out into a riptide. And if you've ever been pulled out into a riptide before, you might know what this feels like. But I was struggling to try and catch my breath, right? So as the water was going up, I was right underneath it, and I couldn't get up. And then as it would go down, I would ride the wave underneath the water, and I just could not get myself up for air. And if you've ever been in a place like that where you're just gasping for air, it's a really scary feeling. You feel alone. You feel desperate. And I just remember as I was like thinking to myself in that moment, and you know, my thoughts were racing. I thought, I'm going to die. I'm not going to make it through this. And just as I was at my last wit's end, I looked up and saw a lifeguard swimming toward me. And I realized that as he was coming toward me, my life wasn't going to be over, that he has extended that buoy to me and I was going to be saved. Now it's funny because like I think right now, maybe since 2020, the way that the world has been crushing us, it can feel like we're just riding the waves underneath the water. We're trying to get up for a breath of air, but sometimes it can feel like it's just really difficult to breathe right now. And we can feel alone, and we can feel desperate. We can feel like we're lost without hope, with no place to begin. We just want you to know this morning, whether or not you can look up from your circumstances and see it, our Savior is running towards you. And he's extending that hand, that grace, whatever it is you need. He wants to walk through life with you. And he's promised to walk with us if we put our faith in him. So this morning, we hope that you can find hope in that Savior that came to this planet, who gave his life for you because he loved you, gave everything for you, and has extended grace and mercy and hope when we need it the most, when we feel crushed. Jesus, we pray this morning you would help us to look up. To look up from our circumstances, to look up from the moments that feel like they're crushing us. We can't feel like we can get a breath of air, and the way the world is going, it just feels like that. And I just pray that this morning you would help us to be able to see you, whether it's in the distance or it's near, to be able to know that you've given everything to help us walk through this world. And we're not alone. We have hope. We have hope for forgiveness of our sins. We have hope for eternity. We've got hope to live a life that's better than just being crushed because you're with us. And we thank you, God, that you love us like that. It's in your name we pray, Jesus. Amen. Yesterday, I had an opportunity to go to a funeral and to do the funeral for a friend. It's always an honor to be able to speak in behalf of someone. But yesterday, as I looked out into the crowd, I saw a group of people that were actually the small group of the person who had passed. And I was just reminded that as that person attended here and they found community in this church, how much that matters and how much that they were living life together and experiencing the troubles of the world together and sharing them. And as I talked with some of the members of that small group, they could reflect on the struggles that that person had had and the hope that they were finding together as they shared those struggles together. And I thought, what a beautiful thing. And they found community here. We hope that you guys can find community here at this church, whatever that might look like for you, whether that's in a small group or serving in a crew somewhere or attending a men's group or a women's group, whatever it looks like for you, we hope that your next step can be developed in a circle with people that care about you and that love you and that want to walk through life with you. And, you know, our mission is accomplished because of the generosity of this church. So thank you for being generous. If you came today prepared to give, we've got several ways to do that. It's on our website, on our app, little box between the doors. But thank you, because as you are generous both financially and with your time, people are finding community, they're finding hope, or finding a way to breathe in the way that this world is operating. We appreciate that. We're going to continue on with our service now.
That we allow ourselves not to be changed. Areas that you won't allow your faith to touch. Where your faith is not penetrating and you don't see it. Vengeance and anger and hurt create blind spots. I'm not talking about good people and evil people, right people and wrong people. I'm talking about places where there should be love, but there's hate. Like maybe your heart. I wonder what is in your blind spot. Who is suffering in your blind spot for the lack of something that you refuse to give? What's in your blind spot?
Have you noticed that everybody else is the problem? Anybody notice that? I mean, I'm a perfect driver. Everybody else is a terrible driver. I always go the appropriate speed for everybody around me, never make any decisions that ever frustrate anybody else. You ever notice how nobody else is good at their job? Everybody else is the problem. I know you think that way. I'm being tongue-in-cheek a little bit. We all think that way, don't we? You ever notice how we think that way? Maybe that's the better question. Everybody else is the problem, not me. But think about where that mindset goes. If I'm thinking it, somebody else is. There's somebody out there who's saying, you know that Phil guy, he's really an idiot, has no clue what he's doing. And they might have a reasonable argument. If we're in a place where we're always thinking, you know, it's always somebody else's fault. Perhaps I can't hold a job, but that's because nobody else could see what I'm bringing to the table. Or if I've been divorced and remarried 5 times, it's because women are the issue. I haven't found the right one. He's always somebody else. But there's a danger in that thinking. There's a danger in always looking outside and never looking inside. So I remember when I was training to get my CDL to drive a bus, worst decision I ever made. A lot of the training, and maybe the truck drivers, you can let me know what existed for you, but so much of the training was the vehicle inspection. Far more than out on the road and what you had to do there, there was this long list of a vehicle inspection. You had to go through everything inside and outside before you ever started the engine, checking the brakes, checking the pressure, checking. I had to check to make sure there weren't tears in the seat because that could be a fire hazard. You know, all these different things that you had to check before you ever started out on the road. I think that's probably a good process for all of us before we start out on the road of the day. To do inspection of our own hearts and our own souls, to go through the checklist to say, God, what's going on inside of me before I ever hit the road for the day? And think about one of the stories that Jesus shared about a speck of sawdust in somebody else's eye and the plank or a beam in our own. You know, we were down at the beach last week. I think I got a little piece of sand in my eye, and that's irritating. It's painful. I would like for somebody to remove that, but if they have a surfboard hanging out of theirs, it's going to be a little difficult to manage. Jesus doesn't say ignore the speck. Don't do anything about the speck, but first remove the beam in your own eye before addressing the speck in somebody else's eye. And the challenge, I think, for us is to look in before we look out. To deal with what's going on inside of us. Not that we ignore the things in our world or the issues that, and maybe we have legitimate gripes. We went down to Myrtle Beach, you're driving on 95, you've been on 95, there's legitimate gripe for other drivers. I'm not saying that we don't address the issues that exist in our world, but we need to first look at us, to begin looking at our own hearts. Because moral superiority can easily blind us to certain things. And the moment I said moral superiority, you're like, oh, you perked up because you're thinking somebody else needs to hear this sermon. That's moral superiority. If you're at a place where you're like, they need to hear this because they don't know that they're worse than me, therefore they're worse than me, that's moral superiority. Any moment that we think somebody else is worse or we're better is moral superiority, and it can blind us to the truths that we need to realize. It's something that came up in the Gospel of Luke in the life of Jesus Christ after Jesus had challenged individuals that he was speaking to get matters right with God before it was too late. A group of individuals come to him and it says this, "Now there were some present at the time who told Jesus about the Galileans, whose blood Pilate had mixed with their sacrifices." Now, this seems like a strange verse. It seems out of place, but we have to understand the context, both culturally and grammatically. Jesus just said, get matters right with God. And in their culture, they believed that somebody who suffered a tragedy suffered that tragedy because God was judging them. And so when they bring this issue to Jesus, they're saying, did you hear about these people who didn't get matters right with God? They say, did you hear about the Galileans? Jesus grew up in Galilee, and there was a cultural norm or cultural perception that Galileans were lower class. Galileans often were zealots. They were opposed to the Roman authorities, and perhaps in this instance, something happened that there were Galileans who opposed the Roman authority in that area, which was Pilate, and Pilate did something about it. He sent individuals to kill those men, and he mixed their blood with the sacrifices. They may have been at the temple, and that's where Pilate found them, killed them, mixed their blood with the sacrifice. And we don't have any other historical record of this moment, but we do have historical record of Pilate doing similar things. Years before Jesus arrived, there were individuals who basically Pilate had taken money from the temple to use that money to fund some of his projects. And individuals from the temple went to Pilate and demanded that money back, and he had sent soldiers disguised in regular civilian clothing, and they went into the crowds and began stabbing people with daggers. That was sort of the norm. It was a spectacle. It was one to not only squash those zealots, but to hinder any other zealots from. Think about a crucifixion. The whole point of it was for it to be public. Imagine going home today and you drive into town and there are bodies strung up on crosses as you're driving into town. The point of it was to squash any insurrection. And so that's what's happening here. And the perception is that this This tragedy that they suffered is because they were not right with God. It was the mindset of the individuals who brought this before Jesus. It was the mindset, if you read in the Old Testament, the story of Job, a man who had so much wealth and was a righteous man of God, but lost everything. When his friends come to encourage him, they say the same thing. They believe that there was some sin in his life, something that God was judging him for. And it was the mindset of the disciples, if you were to read in John's Gospel, chapter 9, they come across a man who was born blind. And the disciples ask Jesus this: who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind? So their perception is the same. The reason he's blind is because of something he did or something his parents did. And Jesus' response is, neither this man nor his parents sinned, but this happened so that the works of God might be displayed. Jesus reveals to them that it wasn't an issue of sin in his life that brought this tragedy. It was God was working to do something. In fact, the disciples were looking back and asking why. Jesus was looking ahead and saying, for what purpose? And I wonder, when we suffer in our lives, which question do we ask? When we face tragedy in our life, do we look back and say why? Or do we look ahead and ask, for what purpose? What is God doing? What is he trying to do in my life? What is he trying to do through my life? There are moments in the scripture where God interacts with individuals because of their sin and pride. But it's faulty to believe that any calamity that I face in life indicates that there's sin in my life. And what Jesus will reveal is that all sin, and that all will perish unless there is repentance. We all fit in the same category. No one worse, no one better. We're all in the same place. And unless we repent, we too will perish. All sin brings judgment eventually. We live under the burden of sin. The whole earth groans, waiting for the redemption of God's sons and daughters. I just think about that this week. Just this week, two individuals in our church lost a sibling, an individual in our church lost a father, and those are just the ones that I know of. We wrestle under the burden of sin. We wear the weight of it because our world is broken and groaning, waiting for Christ's return. Jesus reveals that calamity isn't necessarily because of that sin. And if we fail to look inside, we might be blinded to the realities that we need to see. What I recognize, and he'll go on and share a story, what I recognize is that moral superiority blinds me to the fact that I need change too. It's easy to consider all the change that everybody else needs, but I need it too. Jesus says this: do you think that these Galileans were worse sinners than all the other Galileans because they suffered this way? I tell you, no. But unless you repent, you too will perish. Or those 18 who died when the Tower of Siloam fell on them, do you think they were more guilty than all others living in Jerusalem? I tell you, no. But unless you repent, you too will perish. So Jesus reveals that he understood what they were indicating. He asks the question, do you think that they were worse sinners? And his answer to his own question is no, they were not. They didn't experience this because they were worse sinners. And then he turns it, instead of looking out, he calls them to look in and says, unless you repent, you also will perish. And the word perish throughout the scripture is not, it typically has more to do with just dying. Perish means to be destroyed and is often attached to eternal destruction. And Jesus is saying, unless we repent, unless we turn from where we're headed in our self-righteousness, our sin, our pursuits, and turn to the one who can save us from those things, we also will be destroyed. And he calls all of us to repentance. The truth is, we all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God, and the wage for our sin is death. And unless we repent and turn to the one who paid that wage already, we too will perish. It's only through Jesus Christ that we can be forgiven of our sins, have them wiped away, and be holy and righteous in the eyes of God the Father. It's interesting, Jesus speaks of this tragedy. He says, do you think they were worse sinners? And then he adds another one. They speak of an individual or a group of individuals who died at the hands of men. Jesus shares a story that is almost a natural tragedy. Well, what about the 18 individuals the Tower of Siloam fell upon? It's what our insurance companies would call acts of God. No man did it. It just occurred. Jesus says, do you think that they were worse sinners or more guilty? No. We all fall in the same place. We all need change. That's what Jesus says. And it's very easy to look at the change that other people need. It's more painful and more difficult to look at the change I need. So we're at the beach, and many of you know my family. My wife is of a darker complexion, so therefore most of my children are of a darker complexion. And all week long as we're at the beach, guess who they're worried about? They're worried about me. I don't know why. And maybe it's rightful. It's rightful. They don't make SPF for people of my complexion. Like if they made it, you would go to the store, the bottle would just say, just stay inside. Just don't even go outside. But guess who didn't get burnt this week? And everybody else did. It's really easy to look at somebody else and say, hey, you need to figure this out, but it's not as easy to look at ourselves. We all need change. And I'm not saying that we shouldn't look out for the world around us, but we start with us. It starts with me. What would it look like if I started with myself and said, God, show me where I need to change? I just know that it's a reality. I know that I'm in that place too where I've sat in the chairs in the church, listened to a sermon and say, oh man, thank you, Lord, for having the pastor preach this because so-and-so I know in here needs to hear that, or so-and-so should buy into that. And haven't reflected on myself. I remember standing in worship once and looking around and saying, God, what's wrong with all these people? Not here, another place. Honestly. What's wrong with all these people? And I can't say I've ever had God speak to me audibly, but I felt like through his spirit, he convicted me in my heart. He said, I'm not worried about them. I'm worried about you. Let's start with you. We need change too. The truth is, I need change. The truth is, I need fruit too. We can often stand like this. Jesus shares a story about a religious leader and a tax collector who are in the temple and they're praying to God. And the religious leader says to God, thank you, God, for not making me like other sinners, for not making me like this tax collector. And he goes on to express all of the good things that he has done. But the tax collector stood there and beat his chest and said, I am not worthy to even look upon you, God. Show me mercy and forgiveness. Jesus says it was that man who left justified. It was the humble man who understood that he needed change and he needed fruit in his life that actually walked away justified. Jesus speaks this parable in connection to their question. He says, a man had a fig tree growing in his vineyard. And he went to look for fruit on it, but did not find any. So he said to the man who took care of the vineyard, for 3 years now I've been coming to look for fruit on this fig tree and haven't found any. Cut it down. Why should it use up the soil? Sir, the man replied, leave it alone for one more year, and I'll dig around it, and I'll fertilize it. If it bears fruit next year, fine. If not, then cut it down. God comes looking for fruit. In the parable that Jesus shares here, God comes searching. The vineyard owner comes searching for fruit. When John the Baptist set the stage for Jesus, he called the people to produce fruit unto repentance, or produce fruit that was consistent with repentance. And when they asked him, what is that? He says to those who had plenty, give to those who don't. He said to the tax collectors, stop taking more than you're required to take. He says to the soldiers, stop using your power to subjugate people and to abuse people, but rather serve them. Produce fruit that's consistent with the character of God. Change, no matter the cultural norm, change to be in consistency with the character of God. But how is that produced? It's only produced through the Spirit of God. You and I cannot change and produce fruit on our own. Our responsibility is simply to abide or remain attached to the vine. We are branches attached to the vine, which is the Son, Jesus Christ, and it's through His Spirit that He produces in us what we cannot produce in ourselves. I've been reading this book over the last couple of weeks. It talks about our body, our soul, and our spirit. And the truth is, if I put my faith in Jesus Christ, my spirit has been made alive. It is a new creation. It is righteous, holy, set apart, sanctified. My soul and my body haven't gotten there yet. And what happens too often in my life is I submit to the body, the flesh, and I serve it rather than submitting to the Spirit of God being at work in my life. But it exists. The power exists there for change, for fruit, for love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, gentleness, self-control. All of those things exist in me if the Spirit of God exists in me. I just have to submit to the Spirit of God being at work in me. God is looking for fruit. Too often, moral superiority blinds me to the fruit that is needed in my life. I'm looking for fruit in everybody else's, and God is looking for fruit in mine. I was reading through Romans, and if you read through Paul's letter to the Romans in chapter 1, he kind of paints this picture of a global issue of sin. And how sin continued to progress to a point of basically cultural breakdown. But before the reader could get to the place where they say, yeah, that's right, the whole world is the issue, he begins chapter 2 with this word, you. He says this, you therefore have no excuse. You who pass judgment on someone else, for at whatever point you judge another, you are condemning yourself because you who pass judgment do the same things. Now we know that God's judgment against those who do such things is based on truth. So when you, a mere human being, pass judgment on them and yet do the same things, do you think you will escape God's judgment? Or do you show contempt for the riches of His kindness, forbearance and patience, not realizing that God's kindness is intended to lead you to repentance? By looking out, we recognize sin deserves judgment. But we are also declaring that we deserve it too. And Paul says that we should not ignore the forbearance, kindness, and patience of God that is offered in our sin. Paul would write to Titus, a young pastor. He says, At one time we too were foolish, disobedient, deceived, and enslaved by all kinds of passions and pleasures. We did whatever the flesh told us to do. We lived in malice and envy, being hated and hating one another. But when the kindness and love of God our Savior appeared, He saved us. Not because of righteous things we have done, but because of His mercy. He saved us through the washing of rebirth and renewal by the Holy Spirit, whom He poured out on us generously through Jesus Christ our Savior, so that having been justified by His grace, we might become heirs, having the hope of eternal life. We were once there. But when God's kindness appeared, and notice, the kindness of God is Jesus Christ. He says, when the kindness appeared, He saved us. I need change too. I need fruit too. I need grace too. And it's the kindness of God that leads us to repentance. It's the grace of God that leads us to repentance. I change by understanding the grace of a heavenly Father offered to me through his Son, Jesus Christ. Jesus is the very kindness of God. I praise God for his kindness in my life. I praise God for his grace in my life. If you've received it, I hope you do too. I imagine that in this room we could track, or listening home, we could track and kind of paint a picture of where our lives would have gone were it not for the grace of Jesus Christ. Where we would be today if we were still here today were it not for the grace of Jesus Christ. I need grace. And what I find is that when I am unwilling to offer grace to others, it's because I'm unwilling to accept it for myself. Very often, when we point the finger at others, it's because there's something going on inside of us. That we're either unable to accept the forgiveness of God for, or unwilling to repent of and change. Therefore, we find it easier to point out how everybody else is a failure, or maybe a worse failure than we are. You and I need grace too. Jesus shares this parable. While God comes looking for fruit, God gives every opportunity of grace. 3 years, that was ample time for that tree to bear fruit. And when the landowner says, dig it up, toss it out, it's wasting soil, the tender says, no, give me one more year. It's, again, an extension of grace. It's a picture of how gracious God is. It'll give it more time. And in the time, he says, let me dig around it and manure it. Let me dung it. Neither of those things are pleasant things. I mean, think about it. Maybe there's been times in your life where God has been chipping away at the hardness of your heart, the hard soil that surrounds your heart. It's not pleasant. Maybe you feel like you've been standing in the manure. You use whatever word you need to use in your head to paint the picture. Or you've been surrounded by it, or life has smelled nothing but it, and it's not pleasant. But sometimes those are the moments that God uses to create in us the change that would have never happened without it. I think about stories that I've heard throughout my life. We have a young man who comes to men's ministry. He shares about when he was at the very end of his rope in a prison cell. And God showed up and he saw God in a way that he had never seen him before, and his life was changed. And he said, while I was in prison, I felt freer than I've ever felt in my life. I think about my friend John Thor, who's up at Teen Challenge, who was hiding in a house waiting to kill the man who killed his cousin. And God gripped his heart, and today he is a transformed individual. I thank God for his grace. Individuals who were in the manure pile and God chipping at the hardness of their hearts, he brought them to repentance and life. Maybe you're there. Maybe you're saying, God, this place that I'm in, it is miserable. Perhaps it's a grace that God is using to try to draw you back to himself, to lead you to repentance and change. Often, the figures of a vineyard or a fig tree, they were used to picture Jerusalem, and it made me think of the prophet Isaiah, who wrote a very similar picture. In Isaiah chapter 5, Isaiah writes this, I will sing about the one I love, a song about my loved one's vineyard. The one I love had a vineyard on a very fertile hill. He broke up the soil, he cleared it of stones and planted it with the finest vines. He built a tower in the middle of it and even dug out a wine press there. He expected it to yield good grapes, but it yielded worthless grapes. So now, residents of Jerusalem and men of Judah, please judge between me and my vineyard. What more could I have done for my vineyard than I did? Why, when I expected a yield of good grapes, did it yield worthless grapes? Now I will tell you what I am about to do to my vineyard. I will remove its hedge, and it will be consumed. I will tear down its walls, and it will be trampled. I will make it a wasteland, and it will be pruned or weeded, or will not be pruned or weeded. Thorns and briars will grow up. I will also give orders to the clouds that rain should not fall on it. For the vineyard of the Lord of armies is the house of Israel, and the men of Judah, the plant he delighted in. He expected justice, but saw injustice. He expected righteousness, but heard cries of despair. God has offered a window of grace, but that window will close. I've been reading through Isaiah, and it's interesting that the way God defines himself throughout Isaiah is the Lord of armies. Never noticed that before. Over and over and over again, he says, the Lord of armies. Because there's coming a day where the window of grace will close. And those who have not accepted the payment for their wage of sin will have to pay for that wage. But the window exists today. We need grace, and we need it today. Paul wrote this in 2 Corinthians. He says, we are therefore Christ's ambassadors, as though God were making his appeal through us. We implore you, as an ambassador, we implore you on Christ's behalf, be reconciled to God. Make your relationship with God right. How do we do that? Through Jesus Christ and Christ alone. God made him, Jesus, who had no sin, to be sin for us, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. He took our place so that we could take his. As God's co-workers, he said, we implore, we urge you not to receive God's grace in vain. For he says, in the time of my favor, I heard you. And in the day of salvation, I helped you. I tell you, now is the time of God's favor. Now is the day of salvation. Jesus is saying, what more could I do? I gave everything. Today is the day of salvation. Today is the day to receive God's grace. If you have not received it, today's that day. To turn from self-righteousness or this idea that somehow you could be reconciled to God on your own, you cannot. To turn from that and say, I know that Jesus became my sin for me so that through belief in him, I could become the right standing with God the Father in him. Today's the day to make that decision. And for those of us who have, God's grace has been poured out in abundance. Let's stop starting with looking out. Let's look in first. We still have steps to take. I still need change. I still need to bear fruit. I still each and every day need the grace of the kind Father. Look in before you look out. Let's pray. Father, I thank you for your kindness and grace. I thank you that that window of grace remains open, that you did everything possible to save us, to pay the wage for our sin. But too often we ignore the depths of sin. We ignore what sin has brought, what is done in our world, the brokenness that we feel, the struggle that we endure, the things that we experience, they are because of sin. And you paid the penalty for that. And you have said to us that when you come again, the last enemy that you will place under your feet is death itself. The things that sin has brought, you will place in submission to you. Lord, we look forward to that day, but Lord, I pray that until that day comes, we would be ambassadors of the good news of Jesus Christ, that we would look in at the change that needs to happen in us as we look out into a world with lenses of grace and kindness to see others come to repentance, to see others come to know you and be reconciled with God, that we would implore, that we would urge, that we would be burdened for the world around us to know you because we have experienced your grace, because we have seen your change, because we walk in your fruit. Father, lead us in your Spirit to live out what we could not live out on our own. And we thank you and praise you again for all the goodness that you pour out. In Jesus' name, amen.
Would you guys join us as we close together?
At your feet I'm falling. Oh, Jesus, I surrender. Oh, I surrender. Your kindness lead me to the light. No fear and no shame I can't hide. You bore the nails, you wore the scars. Now I am safe in your arms. And I fall at your feet again. Here's my heart again, Lord, I am yours. And I with my chains undone, all because the love that you have shown. When I hear mercy calling, it's at your feet I'm falling. Oh, Jesus, I surrender. My life, I live.
at your feet again. Here's my heart again, Lord, I am yours. And I run with my chains undone, all because the love that you have shown. When I hear mercy calling, it's at your feet I'm falling. Oh, Jesus, I surrender.
God, as we look into ourselves, as we listen to your Spirit showing us the things that we need to change, the things that we need to work on, the things that we need to allow you to work on in us, I pray that you would show us your kindness, that you would remind us of your kindness, and that that kindness would lead us to repentance. We love you. We want to live in light of the fact that you loved us first. In Jesus' name, amen. Guys, thank you so much for joining us this week. We hope you have a fantastic week, and we'd love to see you back.
2, 3, 4.